Well, I want to tell you, I'm thankful for Facebook because I can keep up with you when you, what you guys are doing down here in Bloomfield. And how many did you have for VBS? How many did you have? 34. Wow, 34 kids for Vacation Bible School. What an incredible deal that is. I saw all those kids, and when I was a principal, I called them all my squirrely kids. And they were squirrely, but I loved them to death. And I love the way they learn. I love what they're very, very perceptive. I ran across a story of, I don't know if it came out of VBS or Sunday school class, but a little girl run home to her mother and said, "Mom, Mom, Mom, I know how God made us." And she said, "Well, really, what'd you learn?" He said, "Well, God put Adam to sleep, and then he took out his brain and made woman." See, what I like about when I tell that story is most of the ladies really laugh, and most of the guys are kind of stoic. So I kind of picked that up. So I also saw that, was it McKenna joined the church? Yep, I saw that on Facebook, and I keep up with the fact that you're providing meals, and so I'm kind of up to speed with you to some degree. I know that Guy likes to talk down here, and I've come up here, and so that's all good. You know, everybody's got to do what they need to do, and I come up here because I can see you better. So, by the way, happy 4th of July. You didn't know it was the 4th of July. I knew it was 4th of July because I was getting ready to go to sleep, and we're over by Red Rock, and bang, pop, boom. And so I didn't get to sleep as late as I would like to have. But I want to just, before I get into the message, I want to just say something about the 4th of July in this country. There's a scripture in James chapter 1, verse 17 says this: "Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows." And I'm here to say you that the United States of America was a perfect gift from God. You go back and read about the founding fathers, and I've done some of that. I have a founder's Bible that's based a lot on, it's a Bible, but it talks about our founding fathers. And you find out we were made a Christian nation. When George Washington was inaugurated, the first thing they did is they went to the little church that, by the way, is still there in New York. It's in New York because that's where he got inaugurated. They went to that church and they had a prayer meeting that God would bless this nation. And God has blessed it. Marty made a comment earlier this week. She said, "We got to live through the best of the United States of America." Well, I don't know if that's necessarily true, but we did. My dad was of the great generation, and he was in World War II, and we went in the Air Force. We went all over this country. Marty and I have been in almost every state of this country, and we live in a beautiful nation that God established. And we Christians need to be proud of that, and we need to stand up for it. I came across this. For many Americans, the 4th of July serves as a day to watch fireworks and have barbecues and have a good time with friends and family. And there's nothing wrong with that. We should celebrate. It's a celebration. But we need to remember that this was, God put us here for a purpose. Do you know that most of the missionaries that have impacted the world in the modern day has come from this country until recently? It came from God established our country to be able to have the resources to send men and women out to tell the good news of Jesus Christ. And that's something we need to realize as citizens and as Christians. And so I want to just recognize that fact. that God established this country. And we are in a conflict about who's going to run this country and who's not. And we've gone way down the road, in my mind, the wrong way, because we've taken God out of our schools, we've taken God out of our government, we've taken God out of a lot of things. And when God was in the middle of it, we weren't perfect, but when God was in the middle of it, this country grew and became the most powerful nation in the world. And not that that's power, but the wealthiest and powerful to do good. And so I just want to make sure we recognize that this morning, that we're in a good country, but we need to stand up for the right principles. And I see that more and more in this last year, and I hope we'll continue to do that. Well, I told you the last time I was here, how long has it been, a year? No, it's been a month. It's been about a month. I said, well, I'm going to continue the series of regarding Elijah. And the incredible thing, and the reason that Elijah was I did a series that involved Elijah, but also Elisha. And the reason Elijah is so fascinating to me is he's never died. Scripture says he never died. And so I'm fascinated by that. So I wanted to focus on him and really do a study of him, because we can learn from him things that will impact us and help us in our relationship to God Almighty. So if you remember when I was here, we talked all the way through the Mount Carmel experience. We found out that he's a man of prayer. He was a man of prayer. We find out that he's very close to God. We found out that he's a man of great faith. And God used him mightily in his day to try to bring Israel back from the disaster of following idols and going astray from what God had planned for them. So he raised up Elijah. Many believe that Elijah, if you remember, many believe that Elijah is a Gentile. A lot of people don't talk about that, but there's good evidence to indicate he was a Gentile. And I'm not going to go into all that, but it makes it interesting to me, because when Jesus was transfigured on the Mount of Transfiguration, Elijah showed up. Do you remember? Elijah was one of them who showed up. If he represented the Gentiles, that was a symbol that Jesus was going to reach the Gentiles as well as the Jews. So I find that kind of interesting. Remember, there was a drought, and Elijah told King Ahab, there's going to be a drought, and it won't end until my word. And then, so there was a drought, and he went to a creek, and God fed him there and with ravens, and the stream dried up, and he sent him to a widow in a Gentile nation. And there he provided food in a miraculous way and healed the widow's son, who was taking care of them and him. And then the time came when he had Elijah get a hold of Ahab and call him to Mount Carmel. And you remember the Mount Carmel experience? What an incredible experience. He called down fire from heaven, and fire consumed the sacrifice. And then they slaughtered the prophets of Baal, because they were false. And so if you remember, this was in 1 Kings chapter 18. We did a lot of things happened, and we went to we're going to move into chapter 19. Now I want to just review the first five verses of 19, because we went through that the last time I was here. And so Mount Carmel's happened, incredible thing, miraculous stuff. The rains come, and Ahab's fleeing from the mountain to get away. That's because it'll get muddy. He flees with his chariots, and Elijah grabs up his robes, and he runs in front of the chariot. That's 25, 30 miles an hour. Could you do that for 20 miles? That's how far away they were to Jezreel. So he was full of the Spirit, and miraculous things were happening. He's pumped up. And we get to verse 19. Let's look at what it says. Now Ahab told Jezebel everything Elijah had done, because Ahab was there, and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. They slaughtered 400 prophets because they were false. Scripture goes on to say, so Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, many may the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not take your life like that, like one of them, those prophets that he had killed. And I said, notice what it says here, because this is where we're going to start. Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. And when he came to Beersheba, by the way, that was over 100 miles away in Judah, he left his servant there while he himself went into a day's journey into the wilderness. He came to a broom bush, that's a big bush, sat down under it and prayed that the Lord might, that he might die. And notice what he says, I've had enough, Lord. Have you ever reached that point? I've had enough, Lord. He said, take my life. I am no better than my ancestors. Then he lay down under the bush and fell asleep. And all at once an angel touched him and said to him, get up and eat. Now, I want to stop there for a minute. I want to talk, why would he get so fearful? Think about it. Here's a man that said it wasn't going to rain for 3 years and it didn't rain. Here's a man who called out to God and healed a boy who had died for the widow. Here's a man who called on God to provide food through a small jar of oil and a small jar of flour for 3 years. It kept filling up. Miraculous. Wouldn't you think he's got it all together? That's who Elijah is. He's got it all together. Then he goes to Mount Carmel and he has a face-off with 400 prophets of Baal. Wouldn't you like to have been there? I would have liked to have been there. I could just see him razzing those guys that were the prophets of Baal. Well, where's your God? How come you can't get the fire to fall? And then, after they tried to get it to fall for all day, evening comes and he says, let's just build our altar. He has them help him build the altar. They put sacrifice on it. They dig a trench around it. They pour water on it. And they get it just saturated. And then he says a simple prayer. And God sends the fire. And consumes the sacrifice, the altar, and all the water that's in the trench. Wow! And the people just bow down and said, God is God. And Elijah says, take these false prophets and let's deal with them as they should be dealt with. And they killed them all. And then he gets this letter from Jezebel. And he became afraid. The scripture says he became afraid. Listen to me now. It doesn't matter if you're a believer or not, fear can consume you. Fear can overwhelm you. Fear can just take charge of your life. Psychologists today say that when fear dominates the mind, we go into what's called fight or flight, right? For me, most of the time it was flight, but sometimes you get back in the corner and your mind just takes over and you fight to survive. You fight you're just overwhelmed and you can't control things. It kind of reminds me of a story that was told by Chuck Swindoll. Y'all know who Chuck Swindoll is? A pastor and evangelist. And he wrote a book called The Tale of the Tardy Ox Goat. And he had a brother named Orville. And Orville worked in the public library in Houston, Texas. Houston, Texas had a big old building, public library. Went like five stories up. And Orville was a little bit of a mess. You ever known guys that are kind of a mess? They're always trying to pull something on you. And they had a crew, that the librarians and those that cared for the library, and they had a crew of about 10 or 15 people, and people come in and out, and they got a brand new guy. Kind of a timid guy, kind of skinny, and but he's pretty nervous kind of a guy. And one of the tasks you had to do at the library was at the end of the day occurred, you had to turn all the lights out. The worst place to turn the lights out was upstairs at the very top of the stacks. And when you turned the light out up there, it went totally black. And you had to come down the stairs. It was right near the stairs, but then you had to come down the stairs. And it was an old building. They didn't have it lighted properly. So this young guy had been given the task to turn the lights out. This new guy, this nervous guy. And they kind of picked on him a little bit. And so he started up to do that, to turn the lights out. And Orville went up the back staircase to the top. And he got in this behind the stacks there, all the stacks of books. And he got up, and the kid got up. Things were going pretty good till he got to the top, which is a spooky kind of place. It's dark. And all the old stacks, nobody hardly ever went up there. And it's kind of dark. And when you've ever been in this situation, I don't know what you do, but he started humming, "Jesus Loves Me." Click, turn the light off. Click, turn the next light off. Starts getting darker. He got to the last light, and he's humming pretty hard now, because it's really getting dark, near 11 o'clock at night. And he started singing the words, "Jesus loves me." He hit that last light, and Orville jumped out from behind the stacks and said, "What are you doing up here?" He never touched the stairs, according to Orville. He flew down those stairs and headed out right out the entrance, and they never saw him again. Never even came back and picked up a check. Now, let me tell you what happened. Fear overwhelmed that young man. I don't know who he was, but I'll bet he never goes to another library again. But that's what happened. He was so overwhelmed that he just flew down those stairs. And like that young man, Elijah, his mind became full of fear because Jezebel threatened him. He said, "By this time tomorrow, you will be as those dead prophets." And he just panicked. That, by the way, goes with fear. Panic. And he just takes off. He's threatened it. And this great man of God, now listen, this is an important story because it can happen to anybody, no matter how godly a person you are, no matter how you've just had it together. And I was a principal for 25 years, and I thought I had it together, and I can tell you, fear can hammer you right, like, just before you know it. I had it happen in my job. But that's what happened here. He's full of fear over Jezebel's threat, and he flees. Fear is just below the surface of our consciousness and can flare to the front when one single incident like this happens. And so it's either run or fight. In this case, he fled. And we see in the scripture that he got to this broom bush and he's reached a point where he's exhausted. That's another thing fear will do. It'll wear you out. And he goes down under that bush, lays down under the bush, and says, "Lord, I've had it." Have you ever been there? "Lord, I've had it. Just take me. Just kill me." This is a lot what Elijah said. "Just take me. Just kill me." Well, let's look on and read what goes on here, starting in verse 5 now. Let me reread 5. It says, "Then he lay down under the bush and fell asleep. All at once, an angel touched him and said, 'Get up and eat.' He looked around, and there by his head was some bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water. He ate and drank and then lay down again. The angel of the Lord came back a second time, touched him and said, 'Get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you.' So he got up and ate and drank. Strengthened by the food, he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. There he went into the cave and spent the night." Listen, God understands that we can get fearful. Listen to me now. He understands. And he will. I love the songs you picked. I don't know how you guys do that. It's not you guys. It's God in us. It fits what we're talking about here. God understands when we're incredibly fearful. And he understood that Elijah's fear. Notice how God deals with Elijah in these verses and in the verses to follow. And I think it's important because he deals with us in the same manner when we who are believers are overcome by our fears. Notice that he had Elijah rest. Hear me now. We need to rest. When we've been overwhelmed by situations and fear, we need to rest. And God had him lay down in a quiet place and rest. And God encouraged us by sending an angel. Anybody here have an angel been sent to you? I haven't, but he did. He had an angel sent to him. By the way, sometimes we get to see angels and don't even know they're there. But they're there, and they do just the right thing to help us in our fearfulness. So he had food and water for him. And sometimes fear comes on us and overwhelms us because we're fatigued both physically and mentally. And Elijah certainly was. And we need to understand that when this happens, we need to take time to rest and renew our strength. Rest helps us gain a clearer perspective. Now, I can remember one time, I had more than one. I could go back into my youth when I was scared spitless in a dark barn. I think every youth who ever got caught in a dark spot could realize that. But I was overcome by fear as a principal. I had just taken the job as principal and superintendent of a small school district. I told him, I can do the superintendent's job too so we can save money and be able to provide other programs for kids. So I took that job on. And in that time, they wanted to have a building project that was around $6 million. I didn't know anything about that. I had to have a lot of assistance from the state, and they were very good about helping me. But I had to pass a bond for this to happen. And I went out in the community and tried to sell the bond. And there was some resistance. I had a PowerPoint program. I showed them, here's why we need it. And we need it. It had some areas that were really in bad shape. But some in the community wanted to build a brand new gym. And I didn't realize there had been a war over that. Another gymnasium in the district. But I tried to sell it because that's what the committee wanted to do. And we had our vote. And I'm working hard because I'm trying to do a superintendent's job and the high school principal's job. And the bond failed. And I can tell you right now what happened. I got overwhelmed with fear. Fear, listen, it's really basic to all fear. Fear of failure. Fear of failure. I said I could do something and it's not looking like I can do it. And I was overwhelmed. And one of the things, I think I've told the story here, is I had a superintendent who caught me at a big convention and just sat me down and said, how are you doing? I said, I'm not doing good. He said, here's what you need to do. And I told him what happened and that I was feeling just totally overwhelmed and fear of failing. He said, first thing you do, go talk to your board members that you trust. I had two that I didn't trust. I had three that I did trust. Go talk to those board members. And he says, you need to take some time off. You need to go rest. And so that was one of the things I did. Marty and I, we had friends in the community. They sent us to one of their condos up in the mountains where there's snow. And we rented a snowmobile and we just got away from it all. And the board allowed me to do that. Listen, this is what this is saying. Sometimes we can be overcome by fear, and this story relates that. God's trying to teach us through Elijah. You need to go someplace and rest. I took 6 weeks off. I was only going to take two, but that didn't work. They said, you take whatever you need. I had the sick leave, and I took the time to take off. That's the key here, because that's what God's saying. When we're overwhelmed with fear, and even you're overwhelmed with discouragement, you need to take some time off, go somewhere where you're away from it. And that's what Elijah did. And God ministered to him there. It says in verse 7 that the angel came back, came to him. It says in those verses, he came to him, and then he came back a second time and gave him what he needed to make the trip to Mount Horeb. Now, Mount Horeb's significant because Mount Horeb's where Moses, God spoke to Moses in a burning bush on Mount Horeb. It's where the law was given, is Mount Horeb. So it's a significant place. It's at least 150 miles away from where he is right now. Notice, he went 40 days and 40 nights to do the trip. Now, it's kind of rugged. It's a rugged place. So he's out in the wilderness now and going to a place where he's being driven by God in his spirit. And he gets there. We see that in verse 10 or verse 12. So look what it says here in verse 9. Verse 9 says, there he went into a cave and spent the night. And the word of the Lord came to him. What are you doing here, Elijah? I want to pause a minute before I finish reading this. Many people think, what are you doing here physically? But let me give you a different perspective. What if God's saying to Elijah, what are you doing here mentally? What are you doing here mentally? So God says, what are you doing here, Elijah? And Elijah replies, I've been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I'm the only one left. And now they're trying to kill me too. The Lord said, go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. So let's kind of review this. When he gets to the mountain, he gets into a cave and spends the night, and the word of God comes to him and says, what are you doing here, Elijah? And in his response, he totally bares his soul to God. I've done everything you've asked me to do, God. Have you ever been there, desperate? I've done everything you've asked me to do, God, and now I'm in this mess. Jezebel wants to kill me. He didn't say that. But he believed God knew that. He wants to kill me, and there's nobody left but me. Now, how many have ever gone there? It's only me. Nobody else is being persecuted. Nobody else is having to deal with this. It's just me. When I was a kid, I did that all the time. And Mom and Dad just slapped me upside the head. You're not the only one. That's what they would. Kind of figure out, well, I guess I'm not the only one. But he tells God this. And so God says to him, okay, he didn't smack him upside the head. Always thought that. He just kind of, come on, Elijah, get it together. And do that. You know why? Because God understands us to the very depths of our soul and exactly what we need to overcome fear or discouragement or whatever the issue may be. So the Lord tells them to go out on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, and the Lord is going to pass by. Wow. The Lord's going to pass by. God knows that Elijah needs a renewed vision of God. And many times every time, that's all we need, is a new vision of God. Because our vision got warped by focusing on the situation that caused the fear. So he goes out and stands. Now notice what happens. Wind and storm and fire all come by. And listen, those are symbolic of the things of the world and the events that can cause fear. You hear that? Those are things that can cause fear. There are forces in the world, both natural and man-made, that can tear mountains apart, consume our goods, and cause great havoc. And listen, God is not in those things. He's not there. And Elijah recognized it, and believers will too. He recognized it. But listen, when he heard a still, small voice, he immediately knew God was present. Notice what he does. He wraps his cloak around and covers his head because he knows he's about to enter the very presence of God. And he goes out there and stands. Now listen, this is a very sacred thing. Have you ever had God show up in a church service, at a revival service, in your car, in His spirit, and you knew He was there? Did you not feel awe and realize you're in the very presence of a holy, righteous God who showed up to you? Because He loves you. That's what Elijah felt here. Now notice what happens. Look at verse 13 again. It says, verse 13, when Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. Then a voice said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Same question. What are you doing here, Elijah? Remember, take the perspective of not so much physically why you're here, but why you're here mentally. And notice what he says. He replied. This is Elijah speaking. He replied, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I'm the only one left, and now they're trying to kill me too." He bares his soul. Listen to me now. What do you mean to have that kind of relationship with God Almighty? In your prayer life, don't be afraid to bare your soul to God. By the way, He knows it all anyway. He just bared his soul. Now notice what the Lord says then. The Lord said to him, "Go back the way you came and go to the desert of Damascus. When you get there, anoint Hazael, king of Aram, over Aram. Also anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, king over Israel, and anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, from Abel-Meholah, to succeed you as prophet. Jehu will put to death any who escape the sword of Hazael, and Elisha will put to death any who escape the sword of Jehu. Yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, all whose knee have not bowed down to Baal, and whose mouths have not kissed him." Wow, now listen, this is important. When we get overwhelmed with fear and we're just all just discouraged to the point of despair, when those times come, we need to do some simple things like retreating from the circumstances that are causing the fear, and then get rested and restore the resources that have been depleted. But we also need to seek God. Elijah understood this. He retreated. He also needed to seek God. And when he sought God, he sought Him out. And in the most sacred place he could think of, the Mount Horeb, where the law was given. Now, when we do that, God is faithful in that He will help us gain perspective on the real circumstances and to put our fears in their proper place. Out in front of the cave entrance, God asked Elijah, why was he there? And Elijah told him why. Now notice God's response. He didn't grab him by the shirt and say, "Come on, Elijah, get it together." That's kind of a man thing. We think maybe you got to get them together. I know my son, we had an earthquake in Nampa, Idaho. And my son was so fearful of the earthquake that he ran outside and He was like 11 years old. And mom went out and grabbed him by the arm and slapped him across the face. Get a hold of yourself. He straightened right up. But see, God didn't work that way. God didn't work that way. Notice what he does. Listen about fear. God's response was to get Elijah back on track because he was a prophet of God. And he needed help him correct the warped view he had of his situation. By the way, fear will do that. Fear will cause you to get a warped view of reality. And so God understood that. Elijah was, he gave Elijah stuff to do. He said, you go to Ezeel over in Aram, the kingdom next to Israel, and anoint him king, and then anoint Jehu king over Israel. And you want to read about an interesting guy, read about Jehu. It follows in the scripture here. Because he took care of Jezebel and Ahab. He was the one that brought judgment on those two. And then it says, anoint Elisha to succeed him as God's prophet. These three men were going to bring judgment on the people of Israel and on the house of Ahab. Now listen to what God says. You are not alone. Why do we come to church? We find out we're not alone. Why do we come to church? So we can share the issues we're dealing with and we get supportive prayer from other people and that we can get help and lifted up and encouraged. Don't neglect, it says so in Hebrews, don't neglect the gathering together of yourselves. Don't neglect it. Because that's where you can gain help. There were 7,000 Israelites, it says, who had not bowed the knee or kissed the idol of Baal. And by that way, that was a way of showing allegiance to that God. And 7,000 had not done it. Now, this is a country of over a million, but it didn't matter. There were those that were had Elijah's back. God helps us overcome those overwhelming fears. But for that to happen, we need to get our eyes off the circumstances and get them on him. That's why it's so important to come to church. So important to be a part of a small group. So important to gather together frequently. Especially when we're overwhelmed. Now, I know what the man thing is. When things get tough, you want to go off by yourself. You want to get caught up watching TV, or you want to go into a book, or you just want to do something like that. But listen, we need to seek God. You go for a walk in the woods and talk to God, because by the way, he'll always be there. He's always there. If you gave your life to Jesus Christ, you got the Holy Spirit, and he's with you all the time. I know that to be absolutely true. But we can get so focused on these issues over here that are causing me pain or fear or all those kinds of things, and we miss the boat. Because let me tell you something about Elijah. The last message I'm going to give is when God comes and gets him. When the chariot comes down, he goes up. Never died. Elijah never died. Do you know between this incident and when God comes and takes him, 20 years went by. He ministered for 20 years. And we never see him fearful about anything after this. So when we get fearful and we get discouraged, we need to get rested and we need to go to God and we need to get help from our fellow Christians and believers, but we need to go to God and just wait on him. Elijah waited on him and waited until God spoke. And when God spoke, God said, okay, Elijah, here's what you're going to go do. You get out of here tomorrow morning. You're going to go to this place and anoint. It wasn't necessarily in the order he gave him, but you're going to anoint Elisha. You're going to anoint Hazael. and you're going to anoint Jehu. He didn't even anoint Jehu. He sent somebody else to do, because Jehu was a bad guy. Because when he told his servant to go anoint Jehu, he said, after you anoint him, get out of there and run. Because Jehu went to town on Ahab and Jezebel and the whole family, took care of business. And so we need to just do what God, we need to go to God and get his help when we're overwhelmed with fear and even in the point of discouragement. So I'm going to close with this poem. Y'all knew who Annie Johnson Flint is. If you have a hymnal, open it up. Annie Johnson Flint's going to show up. She was born in 1866, so she's great grandparent of somebody. But she was born in 1866, and she went to normal school. They called it normal school then. She went to normal school, and she got out. 3 years later, she went into the teaching profession, but because of debilitating arthritis, she could not function. Terrible arthritic pain. Her hands and legs would all cramp up. So she was forced to spend the rest of her life dealing with pain and as an invalid. But she was a devout Christian. She loved God. She had turned to God as a young girl, and she loved God. And she has written some incredible poems when you understand her background. And I want to close by having you listen to one of her poems. And she entitled it, But God. It's kind of like what Elijah did. But God, I'm being persecuted. I'm on all this. But listen to this poem. This is her poem. I know not, but God knows. I know not, but God knows. O blessed rest from fear. All my unfolding days to him are plain and clear. Each anxious, puzzled why from doubt or dread that grows finds answers in this thought. I know not, but he knows. Can you have a better friend than that? I cannot, but God can. O balm of all my care, the burden that I drop, his hand will lift and bear. Though eagle pinions tire, I walk where once I ran. This is my strength to know, I cannot, but he can. I see not, but God sees. O all-sufficient light, my dark and hidden way to him is always bright. My strained and peering eyes may close in restful ease, and I in peace may sleep. I see not. I see not, but he sees. This is a woman who spent her whole life dealing with pain and the fear that comes with that kind of pain, with no possible cure, and yet she can have a heart like that. The only way she could have a heart like that is because of the relationship she had with God Almighty. That's the God we serve. And you see this in the story of Elijah. A man just overwhelmed with fear comes to God, and God gives him exactly what he needs to overcome that fear and be victorious. And he was. You'll never see that fear in him again. We can have the same thing in our relationship to God. And I don't know if anybody here is dealing with any kind of fear or discouragement. We all have some form of discouragement, maybe. But we serve a God who can make us victorious even in the midst of it. We just need to put our faith in him, take care of ourselves, and put our faith in him. And that would be my prayer for you this week and in the weeks to come. See, I realize that you've been looking for a pastor a long time. And you get pretty discouraged. But keep your faith, keep your mind on God Almighty. And he's going to bring this through to you'll be amazed at what God does for you. Stand with me as we close with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I come to you this evening or this morning. Thank you so much for your presence, Lord. I'm always amazed at how you interact with the church, all the people, and the music fits, and the prayers fit, and everything just fits together, and it should make every Christian joyful that God's in control, because that's a clear testimony of that fact. Lord, I just praise and thank you for who you are and what you're doing in this church. Lord, I know you did some incredible things in Vacation Bible School. I know you've done some incredible things with the quizzing program and all those that have been involved in quizzing. I know, Lord, that you do an incredible thing through the meal ministry. Lord, you're working, you're here, you have a plan, and we just need to make sure we're on board and that we don't get discouraged. We stay true to form and busy about your work, just as you directed Elijah to be busy about his work. I pray, Lord, that you just be with each and every one that's here this morning, that they would sense your presence all day long. And through tomorrow, as we celebrate the birth of this nation and all it's tied to, Lord, I would lift up our nation to you and pray that you would intervene. And I can see you making a move to move us back to where we need to be. I just pray, Lord, that you would help us to stand tall and do what we need to do to be a part of that. Go with each one, I pray. I just ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless each and every one of you.
Grace can never change. Oh.